morning, everyone. Thank you for spending your 10 o'clock hour on a Monday with us. My name is Colleen Murphy. I am LASA's outreach coordinator. We know that you are all very busy folks doing some really important work, so we are very grateful that you took the time today to learn a little bit more about hepatitis A. And we have a very amazing guest with us today from the Department of Public Health. And we are very excited to introduce Dr. Belcher, who's the Director of Acute Communicable Disease Control. We also have some of our other colleagues here from LASA who represent LASA's emergency response team, our emergency shelter, as well as policy and planning. And so we would like to invite you during the presentation to go ahead and put in your questions at the bottom of the screen. And then at the end of the presentation, we'll go ahead and answer some of the questions, and anything that we don't have time to address, we'll go ahead and type up some notes afterwards to address it. So what we're going to be doing is I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Belcher. But before that, if anyone's having any issues listening, if they could go ahead and put it in the chat bar just to let us know if everything is okay audio-wise. Give it a few minutes. Okay, it looks like everything is good. So I'll turn it over to Dr. Belcher. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Dr. Sharon Belcher, and I work for the Los Angeles County Department of Health. I'm happy to be here with you to talk about hepatitis A. Today, we'll talk about what you can do to protect yourself and others. By the end of this presentation, we will be able to describe hepatitis A, learn how hepatitis A is spread, identify who is at risk for getting hepatitis A, and describe what we can do to prevent hepatitis A. So first, I'm going to start by defining what hepatitis A is. Hepatitis A is a highly contagious liver disease. There are different kinds of hepatitis, but what we will talk about today is hepatitis A. It's caused by the hepatitis virus, which is a germ. Some people have mild cases that can last a few weeks, while others experience severe cases that can last several months and in rare cases be fatal. How does hepatitis A spread? It spreads by putting something in your mouth, an object, food, or drink that's been contaminated with feces or poop of an infected person. It can also be spread by forgetting to wash your hands after using the bathroom or changing diapers, having sexual contact with an infected partner, consuming food or drinks contaminated by the virus, or sharing equipment related to recreational drug use. This is not limited to injection drug use. Sharing of any equipment related to recreational drug use can spread the infection. Persons with hepatitis A can spread the infection for a week before they realize they are sick. And some people may never have symptoms even when they are infected and can still spread the infection. This is one of the reasons hepatitis A is so contagious. Generally, people can only spread the infection for a couple of weeks, but some people will be able to spread it longer or even for months. After you fully recover from hepatitis A, you can never get it again. What are the symptoms of hepatitis A? As I mentioned, some people can have the infection but not have any symptoms. But most adults, about 70%, will have symptoms, and they usually appear between 2 and 6 weeks after the person is exposed to the infection. We will talk more about the symptoms on the next slide. Symptoms include fever, feeling tired, loss of appetite, nausea, vomiting, stomach pain, dark-colored urine or pee. This would be the color of Coca-Cola. Very gray stool or poop. Joint pain and a yellowing of the skin and eyes, which is also called jaundice. How is hepatitis A treated? There is no specific treatment for hepatitis A. So when someone has hepatitis A, treatment includes rest, good nutrition, fluids, and medical monitoring. Some people need to be hospitalized. Anyone who has symptoms of hepatitis A should see a doctor. Death is rare, but is more likely in those who have problems with their liver to begin with, such as chronic hepatitis C, chronic hepatitis B, or alcohol-related liver disease. You may have heard about the hepatitis A outbreak in San Diego and more recently in Santa Cruz. Over the next few slides, we'll share some information and talk about hepatitis A rates in Los Angeles County. The first case of hepatitis A in San Diego appeared on November 24th, 2016. Spread has been very rapid among the homeless population because of poor sanitary conditions. As of September 13th, 2017, San Diego was reporting 421 cases of hepatitis A with 292 hospitalizations, that's a 70% hospitalization rate, and 13 deaths, or 3.8% of the cases. 80% of the outbreak patients are homeless or use illicit drugs. This is an unusually high death rate, and it most likely reflects prior illness in the affected population. By way of comparison, in general in the United States, we have only 100 deaths in the entire country every year from hepatitis A. So to have this number in a single city is very high. In Los Angeles County, we have 35 to 60 cases of hepatitis A every year. Hepatitis A rates are generally highest in people who are 35 to 44 years old. Oh, I'm sorry. I apologize. In the San Diego outbreak, small groups of cases have taken place in people who serve the homeless population. So although most of the case patients are themselves homeless, some people who work with the homeless have also become ill. In addition, there have been cases in jails, residential drug treatment facilities, single room occupancy hotels, and assisted living facilities. There have also been, as I mentioned, a small number of cases among volunteers, sanitation workers, healthcare workers, and a parole officer. In Los Angeles County, there are 35 to 60 cases every year. The highest hepatitis A rates are in people who are 35 to 44 years old. In recent years, we have had no cases among our homeless population. So now we're going to talk about who is at higher risk of getting hepatitis A. So in general, when we are not having an outbreak, anyone can get hepatitis A. Right now, people who are homeless in San Diego are at the highest risk. In regular times, we say that people are at high risk if they travel or live in countries with a high rate of hepatitis A, if they live with someone who has hepatitis A, if they use any recreational drugs, as I mentioned, not just intravenous drugs, if they are a man who has sex with other men, if they have sexual contact with a partner who has hepatitis A, and if they are homeless. But as I mentioned, in San Diego right now, the overwhelming majority of cases are homeless or using recreational drugs. Who is at risk for severe illness? People who are over 50 years of age, people who have an underlying problem with their immune system. We say their immunity is compromised either by an illness, such as HIV, or by a medication, such as chemotherapy. People who have hepatitis B or C or other liver disease. In these people, the illness may last longer and in rare cases may be fatal. Who should get vaccinated? Since 1999, the vaccine has been available to all children 1 year at 1 year of age and older in Los Angeles County. Any adult who travels to a country where hepatitis A is common should be vaccinated. Family and caregivers of adoptees from countries where hepatitis A is common should be vaccinated. Men who have sex with men, recreational drug users, people with chronic liver disease or hepatitis B or C, or people who are homeless. In addition, people who work closely with the homeless population are recommended to be vaccinated currently. How to prevent hepatitis A? The good news about hepatitis A is that it can be easily prevented. The best way to prevent hepatitis A is by getting vaccinated or getting a shot against hepatitis A, and we will talk more about that later. In addition to vaccination, hand washing with soap and warm water, vigorous scrubbing for 20 seconds before eating or preparing food, after changing diapers, or after using the bathroom. Some people have asked about hand sanitizer. In general, hand sanitizer is not quite as good as vigorous scrubbing with warm soapy water for 20 seconds. However, we understand that soap and water is not always available and that not everybody aggressively washes their hands even when it is. If using hand sanitizer, it's important to use a hand sanitizer that is 60% alcohol. Not all hand sanitizers are alcohol-based. If it is not alcohol-based, it will not work. Because, again, as I mentioned, hand washing facilities are not always available, we do recommend using hand sanitizer in that setting. However, prior to preparing food, it is always important to scrub your hands vigorously for 20 seconds with warm, soapy water, because the distribution of contaminated food has the potential to spread hepatitis A very widely. Other things you can do to prevent hepatitis A are: do not share food, drink, or smokes with other people. Use your own eating utensils. Do not share hygiene items like towels, toothbrushes, razors, or other items. And do not have sex with someone who has hepatitis A. What is the hepatitis A vaccine? As I mentioned, this is the most effective way to prevent hepatitis A. It is a safe and effective vaccine. Ideally, one would get 2 shots 6 months apart. Getting the vaccine is the best way to prevent hepatitis A. While 2 doses offers full protection, a single dose offers excellent protection, especially in adults. If someone has contact with hepatitis A virus, there will be a period of time between 2 and 6 weeks before he or she gets sick. And if you receive a single dose of vaccine within 2 weeks after contact with the hepatitis A virus, illness can be prevented. So even a single dose of hepatitis A vaccine in a healthy adult will prevent infection. So where can people at risk get vaccinated? Your personal doctor or healthcare provider, if he or she does not have the vaccine, it will be available at a local pharmacy. You can receive it at the pharmacy with or without a prescription from your physician, or your physician can obtain it from the pharmacy. You can also go to any LA County clinic at the Department of Health Services, at the Department of Public Health, and the websites to locate these clinics are on the screen. DPH nurses, Department of Public Health nurses, are also working with outreach teams in shelters to offer vaccination. Finally, you can dial 211 to find the clinic nearest to you. What is the Department of Public Health doing to prevent an outbreak in Los Angeles? We are very concerned about spread of the outbreak from San Diego or Santa Cruz to Los Angeles. We are investigating all hepatitis A cases and recommending preventive treatment for all close contacts. However, we are also working to provide hepatitis A vaccination for all homeless people, regardless of recent contact, and conducting health education and promoting vaccination and improved hygiene or cleanliness. If you want more information about hepatitis A, you can obtain it through the LA County Department of Health, Public Health website, or the website at the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. We've also included phone numbers that you can call. If you have questions that we are not able to answer today, though, I think we have plenty of time to take questions. And these are more places that you can get information. Again, you can call 211, visit our website, send us an email, or follow us on social media. So in summary, today we discussed, we described hepatitis A, learned how hepatitis A is spread, identified who is at risk for getting hepatitis A, and described what we And I'm happy to take any questions that you may have now.
Great. Thank you, Doctor. That was very informative. I think one of the take-home messages that I heard was that while we need to be concerned and vigilant and to be educated around how hepatitis A is spread and how we can protect ourselves, the very good news is we have a very effective tool in our toolkit, which is vaccination. And so the fact that we have access to something that is very effective in our toolkit is very, very important for us. And so I think what we'll do is we'll take some questions. And what we'll want you to do too is to go visit those websites because we all need to be educated and empowered to work with our clients to help inform them on why vaccination is so important, how it is safe, and how it will really protect them from getting very ill and potentially from death. So what we'll do is we'll put you on mute for a second. We're going to look at our questions, and then we'll be right back to answer some of them. Okay, we're back. Thank you everyone for your questions. I think the easiest one we'll take is, will we send out the slides? Absolutely. We'll actually be sending out the slides as well as a recording of this. So we'll be very happy if you could then disseminate it amongst your staff and your colleagues and spread this as far and wide. We want the slides spread, hepatitis A not spread. So thank you for that. And so the first question is what is the test for determining if someone has hepatitis A?
So there is a blood test that can be done to determine if someone has hepatitis A. There's two parts to that test, one which looks to see if you have it right now and one which looks to see if you've ever had it. The thing that's good about that test is it's what we call very sensitive. It will detect things. The thing that's bad about that test is there are a lot of false positives. If you test somebody who's never had hepatitis A or doesn't have it now, has no symptoms, is perfectly healthy, you have a very good chance that it's going to test positive even though they don't have it. So we urge people not to get tested unless they actually have symptoms. People say, oh, is there a test I can get now? No, if you have symptoms, there's a test you can get. Also, the other thing to know is if you get vaccinated and you get tested within a couple weeks after that, it will look like you've had hepatitis A because to protect you from it, and it looks like you have it. So there is a test, but you shouldn't rush out and get it unless you have symptoms. What you should rush out and get is the vaccine.
Great, thank you. If you've already been vaccinated against hepatitis A, do you need to get a booster shot?
If you only had one dose, we do recommend the second dose. You are probably good on one dose, but the second dose will make it great. If you've had two doses, you're good. You don't need any more doses.
Great. You stated that not just sharing needles was an issue. So can it be spread by sharing joints, cigarettes, bongs, pipes, eating utensils, and straws?
Yes. Anything that gets contaminated with microscopic bits of stool or poop can spread it. And the problem generally is just poor sanitation. So yes, it can be spread that way. That's why we say it's not limited to injection drug use. It's sharing of any drugs, but also eating utensils, et cetera, objects in general.
Great. Is the vaccine a live virus?
No, no. So anyone could get the vaccine, including pregnant women.
Great. What if I don't know if I've received the vaccination before? Should I take it?
It's not harmful to get revaccinated if you've been vaccinated in the past. So if you don't have a provider you can check with, there's no harm in getting an extra dose.
Another question on the vaccine. What is the chemical makeup of the vaccine? So you mentioned that it's not live. Can you talk about what it is?
It's what they call an inactivated virus. So it's not a live virus, but it has enough pieces in it that look like a virus that it tricks your body into thinking it is the virus and therefore creates the antibodies.
Great. Are there any vaccination clinics planned? I will actually then pass it on. So we're working very closely, we being LASA, as well as the health agency and others, to really have a coordinated response to this. So some of the strategies that we're doing is to attach public health nurses to outreach teams, to shelters, to community care days in the field. So we're looking to extend and expand outreach. One of the things we've noticed at the beginning was that vaccine uptake, meaning the willingness of people to accept the vaccine, has been low. So we're very excited to empower everyone to be able to talk about it, what a vaccine is, what it isn't, how it's there's no side effects to vaccination, how it's extremely effective in preventing infection, and how you really don't want to get infected and that you'll be very, very sick. So we're excited, and you see that rolling out more and more. And so we're working really closely to do that more. And then in the more general community, I don't know, Dr. Balter, do you have any more information on other types of community outreach that's happening?
Well, the specific events can be accessed through our websites, but they have the Department of Health teams have already gone out to a number of places where there are many homeless and there are homeless providers to offer the vaccine on site. In addition, there are the health department clinics. And yes, we are working with organizations such as yours to roll out more and more of these events. There is a problem. They've had this in San Diego, even where the outbreak is ongoing. So people have seen people be sick, have seen people die. Even there, getting people to accept the vaccine has been hard. So it's even harder right now before we've had the outbreak. But as I've said to people, everything you do to prevent an outbreak is exactly what you do after the outbreak occurs. You give vaccine and you try to improve sanitation. So we should not wait for the outbreak. Every person who gets the vaccine is one less person who will get hepatitis and one less person who will die, even if we have an outbreak.
Thank you. And I think one piece to add is that what makes this partnership extremely critical is the partnership and the trust and rapport that we have with those that we serve. And so I think that partnership between us being the liaison between the nurses and the client will be very, very important. So another good question. What is the likelihood of contracting hepatitis A doing street-based outreach?
Well, again, it depends on how meticulous or careful everybody is about hand washing. And, you know, I say this as somebody who thinks about this all the time, and even I am not always perfect about it. So, you know, you really have to aggressively wash your hands before you put them in your mouth. So if you have a tendency, as I sometimes do, the risk is greater than if you don't. If you get vaccinated, you're not going to get hepatitis A. So that's my approach to hepatitis A. Then you are definitely protected.
Great. How does hepatitis A differ from hepatitis B and C?
So hepatitis B and C are very different viruses. They are spread in very different ways. You cannot get hepatitis B and C from eating food that's contaminated with hepatitis. It's spread only through blood. They're spread only through blood and semen. Hepatitis B is more likely to be spread through semen than hepatitis C or from mother child during birth. It's not spread through food. The other difference between B and C is both B and C have a chronic form of the illness. With hepatitis A, once you get it, you will get very sick. In rare cases, you will not recover, but it's not going to persist. You're not going to get it again. With B and C, it can sometimes last indefinitely and continue to make you sick, continue to give you a risk of dying from something like hepatitis A, and it can be difficult to eradicate.
Thank you. What are the statistics for hepatitis A in the Santa Cruz area?
I believe the last time I checked, which is around the time I checked the San Diego numbers, they had 59 cases. However, they are much smaller cities, so they were at pains to emphasize that this is a very high number, even though, you know, it sounds a lot less than 400, but their population is a lot lower.
So I believe you mentioned this, but it bears repeating. If a person never shows symptoms, how long will they continue to have hepatitis A before discovering they do?
Well, they may never discover they do until one of their close contacts gets sick. Usually about 3 weeks is how long you could spread it if you never had symptoms. It's the equivalent of the 2 weeks before and the 1 week after for the person who does get symptoms. But often many children, for example, never get symptoms. And so in an ordinary time, we often discover, say, a child may travel to a country where Hep A is common and return, and that child will never have symptoms, but then their babysitter will get Hep A. That's how we will discover that the child had it, not anyway. So, but it, with adults, at some point.
Great. So for somebody, I can appreciate this question. I have a fear of needles. And does it hurt?
What I would say is go with a friend, hold their hand tightly, and get the shot anyway. Because if you get hepatitis A and you end up in the hospital, there will be far more needles involved. So it's one needle, it's not that large, it's quick. Think of something great you can do for yourself afterwards.
Great answer. Can pregnant women get the hepatitis A vaccine?
They can. You should discuss it with your obstetrician, but they can. As I said, it's an inactivated virus, and actually hepatitis A can be fairly serious in pregnant women. So,
great. I heard that there was a cure that came out a few years ago for hepatitis. Is this false? Is there only treatments for this?
What you are thinking of is for hepatitis C, which is a chronic illness, and absolutely there are some fantastic cures for it now. They are expensive, they're not easy to access, but they are amazing, but they don't apply to hepatitis A.
Great. Are there any side effects when you get the vaccine?
No, in general, there are no side effects. I mean, with every medicine or shot, in very, very rare cases, somebody might have an allergic reaction, but.
Great. So a few questions about boosters again. So if you were vaccinated for hepatitis A before, do you need to get revaccinated?
If you had your full two-dose series, you absolutely do not need another one. If you only had one shot, and it was more than 6 months ago, it's a good idea to get a second one. However, if you only have one shot, if you go out now and you just get one shot, you can go right back out and start working among people who have hepatitis A. That's what we would give you if you had never had a shot and you were exposed to someone with hepatitis A. It's a very good vaccine.
Did the Hep A outbreak in Santa Cruz, was it spread from San Diego?
That is the general theory, yes. We can test the viruses to see if they're related, and they are.
Great. If a health worker or a group of health workers want to go ahead and get vaccinated, what is the best way for them to do that?
Well, I personally love to go to my own provider if I can, but not all providers have the Hep A vaccine. So then I would go to one of the DHS or DPH clinics. And you can either call 211 or go on our website to see where they are. And if you say that, you know, your occupation is to work closely with the homeless, you will get the vaccine. The other option I think that's easy for people if they have insurance is to go to a pharmacy. Pharmacists are allowed to give it even without an order from your doctor.
Great. Just we've got a little bit of time, everyone. So if you have more questions that are burning, please go ahead and enter them now. Okay, good question. Is the Hep A vaccination included in a normal recommended child use vaccination regime?
It is. However, it was only started in 1999. That means that anyone over the age of 18 did not receive the vaccine, most likely.
Great.
Also, I should add, it is not required for school entry. So, depending on your family's approach to vaccine, you may or may not have received it.
Great. So, keep your questions coming in. We're just reviewing what's already in. If something was not answered and you already typed in, go ahead and retype it in.
Okay, somebody asked that I review the symptoms. So this is when you first get, just feel like you have a bad flu, fever, fatigue, or just feeling tired, stomach pains, nausea, occasionally vomiting. Your pee may turn a dark Coca-Cola color. Your stool may turn a clay color, and your skin or eyes may turn yellow.
Are there any known interactions or complications for persons with specific types of disabilities?
Well, the main concern are people who have problems with their immune system. And this can come from, you know, again, HIV is the most common one that we will encounter. And people who are undergoing chemotherapy, people who may be on high doses of steroids. There are a few other drugs that will interfere with your immune system. So those are the people who are at greatest risk from having a serious infection and from having their infection last. The other group that we worry about, I think, as I've mentioned, is people who have underlying liver disease. So people who have chronic hepatitis B, chronic hepatitis C, alcohol-related liver disease, or there are a variety of other less well-known liver diseases that people may have. Those people are at very high risk of dying from hepatitis A relative to other people. I mean, many of them will still recover. I think we all think it's the reason for the high death rate in the San Diego outbreak, that there are more people who are homeless who have these underlying liver diseases and therefore are more vulnerable to a serious infection.
Great, thank you. So in terms of the vaccine working as a preventive measure, does it do anything to help cure somebody?
No, once you have it, you have it.
Okay, thank you. In terms of, there's a question about shelters and whether public health nurses can come into the shelters and provide vaccinations. Absolutely. Your team is working with the Department of Public Health to do this. One of the things to keep in mind is we have a lot of ground, literally and figuratively, to cover. And so when we do this, we're doing it in a tiered approach, looking at some of the bigger shelters and some of the bigger hotspots to do this work and prioritizing them, and then continue to roll it out in secondary hotspots and shelters. So we are coming to a shelter near you. Some of the shelters are already doing this work, and so you'll see this unfold quite rapidly and dramatically, but it will take some time to get the entire county covered. So whatever you can do to access Hep A, hand washing yourself, will be very important to add on. Let's see, let's look. Can you catch the virus via the air? Is it an airborne virus?
You cannot, no.
So can
you have to touch something, it has to get in your mouth.
Great. And What do you think is the barrier between offering vaccination to the homeless population? I'll jump in and then throw it in. It's one of the things I think vaccination, as you have probably know, is a sensitive issue, and that there's a lot of science behind it too. So I think it can be very confusing for any individual, whether you're homeless or not. So trying to understand the science behind it, I think there's a lot of misinformation about risk. So trying to dispel any misinformation can be a process. Also just getting, as somebody put in aptly, getting stuck with the needle is not an awesome thing also. So I think our challenge is to educate ourselves and practice communicating what those risks versus the benefits are. And I think it's also just having a lot of conversations about it, empowering our clients with information. We're putting together some flyers and pointing people to do their own research too, so they feel comfortable. So I think that is, those are some of the barriers, and I'll pass over to Dr. Balta.
Yeah, I would agree with that. I mean, I don't think that it's limited to the homeless, the concerns about vaccination. I think there's some very wealthy neighborhoods in Los Angeles where it would be hard to get people to take the vaccine. I think that it can be compounded by maybe a fear of the government, and many of the people are homeless also have mental illness, so I think it can be harder to understand the importance. And again, I think when, especially in the time before an outbreak, when it's no one's priority, everybody has other things they'd rather do than go get a shot. So, you know, I think there's many, many different reasons that it can be hard to get people to take the vaccine. But this is a great vaccine, and so we would really like to push as hard as we can on it.
So people who are immune suppressed, are they more recommended to receive the vaccination?
They are, and actually even for people who have serious immune suppression, so I'm talking about people on chemotherapy, people who have untreated HIV, so their CD4 count is very low. Even with the vaccine, if they were exposed, there's another medicine we would consider that they should talk to their doctor about getting, called gamma globulin, because those people are at such high risk and their immune systems may not be functioning well enough to respond to the vaccine. So somebody who has untreated HIV or is currently on chemotherapy may not want to do as much field work during, you know, while their immune system is suppressed. Both of those situations will usually resolve over time if treated.
Thank you. Are there any medications that might interact negatively with the hepatitis A vaccine?
Not that I can think of, except for this one issue of the drugs that could seriously suppress your immune system. And there is a long list of those, chemotherapy, steroids. There are certain drugs to treat things like rheumatoid arthritis, which can seriously interfere with your immune system. Most people who are on them know that. You can always ask your provider, he or she should know. Those drugs can interfere with the vaccine actually working.
Great. It looks like we've gone through most of the questions. We still have some time, so I'll keep it running. One thing that would be helpful, if you are in front of your computer, it would be great to do a little informal poll about how comfortable you feel about talking about hepatitis A to your clients, as well as what types of additional knowledge or tools would you like to be able to do that. So feel free to just put it in the questionnaire and we'll look at it after. Okay, great question. In terms of hepatitis A, and I think maybe we'll adjust this to San Diego, how long do you feel that hepatitis A will be in the area now that it's an outbreak, and when do you think that it'll then be eradicated from San Diego? And then looking at Los Angeles, when can we breathe a sigh of relief and know that we're maybe out of harm's way?
It may be a while. The outbreak is continuing to grow in San Diego. Some people have estimated it could last as long as 18 months. I don't think we know for sure. I think the outbreaks need to subside in the places around us before we can feel we're not at risk. I think as long as there are major outbreaks in any city around us, the risk of somebody arriving on a bus and, you know, deciding LA looks like a lovely place to stay is high, and we need to be very, very vigilant. And we are very lucky that so far we have not had a major outbreak, but now is an excellent time to start promoting vaccine to try to improve sanitation, because everything we would do if an outbreak occurred to try to stop the outbreak, we can just as easily do now beforehand, so we should not wait.
Great, thank you. Due to the risk, should our staff that clean the linen wear full protective suits or gloves, or are gloves fine?
Gloves are fine, provided, you know, you do your laundry after you, you know, after you get home, or even before you get home. Like, if you can do your laundry where you work, it's even better.
And the I think the it's for shelter staff who are changing client linens.
Yeah. So, again, I would just be I would just promptly wash your clothes when you get home. I don't necessarily think you need to be wearing full protective suits. People in hospitals don't do that. It's just to be careful about the clothes that you're wearing afterwards.
Us for materials, that's very helpful, and we are putting those together. There are some, but we're adapting them to be more homeless individual friendly. So stay tuned, and we'll be preparing those also. If somebody is infected with hepatitis A, are they at higher risk for opportunistic infections or other diseases?
Well, it's going to depend on how serious your infection is. Some people, as I've mentioned, are not that sick. Some people become extremely ill. Those are generally people who have underlying illness and will end up in the hospital in the intensive care unit. Once that happens, you are at risk for other things. But it doesn't put you at the same kind of risk that, say, HIV would for the opportunistic infections, for things like PCP pneumonia. It's just that whenever you're that, you know, you're at risk for other things.
Are vaccinations available in any other way other than an injection?
No. You do have to get the shot. Again, it's way fewer needles than if you end up in the hospital with hepatitis.
If I got the vaccine and I am exposed, would I be able to acquire hepatitis A and therefore spread it?
It would be very rare. It's such an excellent vaccine that it would be very rare that that would happen.
Are kitchen sponges a hazard for hepatitis A?
If there is hepatitis A on surfaces and you clean with a sponge and you do not disinfect it or throw it out, it is a hazard. Kitchen sponges are generally not just for hepatitis A, but potentially can spread all kinds of things. So they should be discarded after use or sterilized.
And is there something else better to use than a sponge?
Well, so there's a couple of options. In general, with hepatitis A, we promote cleaning with 10% bleach. So that means one part bleach to nine parts water. Then you can use paper towels. I know this is not very environmentally friendly, but you're going to discard them at the end. Or you could use a rag and then wash it immediately.
Okay, so I think there's still some questions about boosters, so we'll want to nail this one down in terms of whether you were vaccinated 45 years ago, 2 years ago, 15 years ago.
No one was vaccinated 45 years ago because it didn't exist. So if someone told you were vaccinated against hepatitis A 45 years ago, that was not the hepatitis A vaccine and you should go get the vaccine. If you were vaccinated 20 years ago, even with the single dose, 95% of people are going to be in good shape. However, if you only had that one dose, for that last 5%, I would recommend getting a second dose. If you had both doses 20 years ago, you should be good.
Great. Does Lysol or any type of disinfectant spray kill the Hep A virus?
again, we really recommend 10% bleach. I do have a list of other solutions that I think the health department is going to put out. I don't know how easily available these other solutions are. Glutaraldehyde, quaternary ammonia solution containing 23% hydrochloric acid, which would be probably toilet bowl cleaner, sodium hypochlorite. I do think that the health department is working on putting these out more directly for people, but home remedy bleach to 9 parts water. That's what I always recommend that people use.
Excellent. There was a recent report that there was a fruit vendor in Lancaster, Spa One. Is there truth to this? And what should we worry about?
There is truth to that. We put out a press release about that. And worked at a few fruit stands. We put out a notification to everybody who may have eaten it that vaccinated, and we did provide vaccinations to people. It was luckily not a very large stand. So in general, what people should do is get the vaccine if they can. This is always a risk. It's not just during a period where there's an outbreak in San Diego. I think we're at greater risk for hepatitis A right now, but there are always cases of hepatitis A periodically in food handlers because many countries do have widespread hepatitis A. So people go visit and they come back. In rare instances, the United States imports food from other countries that had hepatitis A. So I generally think hepatitis A is a great vaccine and recommend it to everyone at all times. And right now it's even more important to get it.
And just to build on that, thankfully we were able to mobilize vaccination campaigns around that area also through our partner agencies as well as through LASA's ERT. So nurses have been going out to do vaccinations and we're looking at doing this approach in other spas too. So I think there's a couple of questions and just to reiterate that we are doing this work ongoing and we will continue to do it. And so you'll start to see nurses be mobilized to do this work. Okay, we have a few more minutes if anyone has questions that they've been too shy to ask. Now is your time. And if an important question did not get answered, you can go ahead and retype it in or if you still have follow-up questions.
But I would like to take one more chance to just push everyone to get vaccinated. It's a great vaccine. I've had it. My child has had it. I recommend it for everyone.
I'll take informal about 7 people in the room. Who here in our room here at LASA Central has been vaccinated against hepatitis A? Okay, so we have about half the group. So what we know about the other half, what they'll be doing later today. And yeah, let's go ahead and do a informal poll too of people who are on, if they themselves feel comfortable about getting vaccinated, if they themselves are not. Oh, here's a new question. Does military personnel require vaccination?
You know, I do not know the answer to that question. I would hope so, but I don't know.
Okay, we will find out. We have a call with the VA, so we'll also be working with the VA system to make sure that great. So we have a number of people who've been vaccinated on and are not, but maybe. Are the figures of the number of cases with HEP
question comes up a lot. We consider it an outbreak really when the cases, there's a couple of definitions. You usually say when it's more than the number you would expect in space and time, which is a complicated definition. I think here what we're considering it is right now we're seeing cases coming in from other communities. And it's clear to us that they're acquiring their hepatitis A in San Diego or Santa Cruz. But once we start to see cases in San Diego, cases are being the fact that it hasn't changed our everything you do to react to an outbreak is exactly what you do to prevent an outbreak. And even if through some like that, I think an outbreak is lately. Even if we manage not to have an outbreak now, we're at risk for an outbreak in the future. It just takes a little bit of food that slips through from a country where they have Hep A. It just takes one person showing up from somewhere else with Hep A in a shelter or homeless encampment for it to begin to spread.
Great.
And so I think there's a couple of follow-up questions
we're having some feedback. Give us one moment.
Great. Just a check. We did. Somebody, if you could just throw in, can you still hear our voices? Okay, I'm going to assume you can. In terms of you talked a little bit about the likelihood of an outbreak. Could you talk a little bit about how we're tracking that?
So every case of hepatitis A that's diagnosed in Los Angeles County is reported to the health department. It's usually reported through the laboratory. The minute they make the diagnosis, they electronically report that to us. Right now, we're also working with hospitals and providers to make sure they call us as soon as the case is diagnosed so we can get quickly to the hospital and interview people and find out where they've been and who they've had contact with. Because otherwise, especially if somebody is homeless, it might be hard to track down. So that's how we are tracking it.
Great. And just to reiterate, if you're not sure if you've had the vaccine, can you get it again?
You should definitely get it again. If you don't know, because it is not harmful to get an extra dose. It's just that after two doses, 6 months apart, it's not going to add any extra benefit, but it's not going to be harmful.
Great. So it looks like that is the end of the questions on Hep A. We've got a couple more minutes, so anything else burning, please feel free to put it through. And so just to reiterate also that we will be working together to expand our ability to vaccinate, whether that's in shelters, street-based outreach, access centers, people going to their doctor. It's going to take a while to get everywhere and anywhere. But again, the quicker, and even if you're more